Andrew and Victoria were a very happy couple. They had been friends since high school, so when Andrew left for the army, the girl waited faithfully for him, sending warm letters. As soon as Andrew returned, the lovers had a modest but fun wedding. Having taken out a loan, the young family bought the abandoned farm and began farming. Of course, at first it was difficult to restore the buildings and sell the produce, but within a year they had developed a strong client base and things began to take off. Victoria soon gave birth to a beautiful baby boy, Justin, who grew up to be a strong and healthy boy. However, Victoria's health began to worsen after giving birth. She could not help her husband as before, she had constant weakness and her weight decreased day by day. Local doctors could not diagnose for a long time, blaming it on hormonal changes associated with childbirth. Then Andrew, unable to endure the anguish of her beloved, took her to the regional hospital. There they urgently did an operation to remove an allegedly benign tumor, but his wife died on the third day without regaining consciousness. Andrew's grief was impossible to describe. Overnight the successful farmer became a widower, with a four-year-old son in his arms. He did not understand how to live further, how to maintain a life so well controlled before Victoria. And how to raise his son was unclear to him. Andrew had no relatives left long ago. There were not many of them, his mother, father, and sister Grace. They all died as a family in a car accident, where 10 other people were injured. The bus in which they were returning from a visit crashed at full speed into a large truck, the driver failed to control the vehicle. The father died immediately at the scene, and 3 other people, including his sister and mother, died a few days later. All this happened 3 months after he left for the army, so the year of service was like a nightmare for him. Now it's a loss again, but he is just with little Justin. One thing pleased his father, the boy grew up very kind and affectionate. He never passed by an abandoned dog or a bird hit by boys. Justin went to school early, and teachers only praised Andrew's son. The only remarks, if any, were about his behavior. And even then, after sorting it out, Andrew realized that his son could not do otherwise. After all, if the boys a couple of years older began to offend a girl from Justin's class, he, without looking at the difference in age and weight class, began to furiously defend his friend. The father, of course, tried to calm down this fighter for justice for educational purposes, but without punishment and giving him a chance to defend his rights. On weekends and vacations it was impossible to get him home. He was the most active player on the basketball court. He especially loved the days when his father could find time to go fishing with him. But even if Andrew was busy, the boy would get up at 4 in the morning and, taking all the necessary fishing gear, would go to the bank of the local river. When Justin would return, he would joyfully inform his father that today he could cook fish soup for dinner and he would show off his catch. At such moments he spoke so proudly about it that Daddy with a smile answered, "Well, well done. That's what a fisherman does. With you, we won't go hungry." They had fun making fish soup and always over a campfire. It became a kind of ritual when the catch was good. Justin always looked forward to summer vacations, when he could only do what he liked, ride his bicycle from morning till night, play catch, read his favorite books and go fishing. But the summer that came made Andrew wary. His son's behavior had drastically changed, he had become somehow quiet and withdrawn. Several times his father noticed that food was disappearing from the house. The boy, knowing how hard his father worked, would never give anything away. One day, after seeing his late wife's favorite scarf on the floor, Andrew looked in his closet and noticed that several of her dresses and blouses were missing. This was no longer at all clear to the farmer, and Andrew decided to track his son. In the morning, supposedly leaving for the farm, he waited for his son to go somewhere with a bag in his hands. Almost at the edge of the forest stood an old crooked house. Andrew didn't even know whose it was, since it had been boarded up for 15 years. At this moment, however, one of the windows was open, and a young pregnant woman came out of the door, joyfully walking towards Justin. "You're my savior. I can't imagine what I would do without you." She put her arm around the boy's shoulders and patted his head. Andrew was stunned by what he saw and decided he needed to clear everything up right on the spot. Stepping out from behind the crumbling barn he was hiding behind, he headed toward the couple. "May I ask what's going on here?" Andrew began in a stern voice. "Daddy, have you been spying on me?" The boy wasn't the least bit frightened, but he looked at his father with some adult reproach. The girl, blushing, lowered the bag to the ground. "Please don't scold Justin," she said faintly, "he's not guilty of anything. Justin is a wonderful boy, and he just wanted to help me. Brooke suggested we go inside and talk." Andrew was hesitant at first, but out of curiosity decided to listen to how the son managed to get into another story with his kindness. Brooke was an only child in a family of completely devastated parents. Her mother and father drank every day, not even thinking about where their daughter was or if she had eaten that day. As she grew older, Brooke often wondered why her mother and father had never been deprived of parental rights. But with a lot of grief and the help of concerned people, she graduated from high school and grew up to be an indescribably beautiful and intelligent girl. Wheat, long, waist-length hair, with gentle curls at the temples. Large, brown eyes, framed by long eyelashes, literally enchanted those around her. Brooke was not surprised by the admiring glances of young men, and to compliment she only lowered her eyes and blushed heavily. After school, Brooke got a job at one of the supermarkets. One day during her working day, she noticed a young man not averting his gaze. "Good afternoon, can I help you with something?" Brooke kindly asked. "I just don't know where to start. When I saw you, I was speechless. I may be out of my mind for a long time, but by the end of your shift, I will definitely be good and be able to walk you home," the young man replied. When he found out when Brooke was finishing work, the guy admired the girl through the huge glass of the window and waved. That whole evening they walked through the park, not shutting up for a minute. The man's name was Cody, and he was an amazing conversationalist. The girl did not take her eyes off him and listened to every word, as if she was afraid of missing something. The spark clicked between the two young people, and on the first night they realized they were in love at first sight. From that day on they met every day and spent all their free time together. Brooke was a little embarrassed that the guy's family was one of the most famous and respected in the city, and she was even scared to think about her own. But love overshadowed reason, and she immediately chased all fears away, reassured by the fact that Cody was a rock for her. The world beside him seemed calm and somehow warm. He, having no limits on her finances, tried to pamper her sweetheart, every time arranging a pleasant surprise. Unexpected trips to the local attractions, or a romantic dinner at the lake, everything was just for her. Soon, celebrating Brooke's 18th birthday, Cody insisted on meeting his mother and father. The girl was very afraid of this meeting, but it seems that there was no way to avoid it. When she saw the three-story mansion, surrounded by a high fence with cameras in the corners, Brooke wanted to run without a backward glance. Her beloved, understanding her fear, took her by the hand, looked her in the eye, and said, "Come on, baby. Everything will be fine, I'm with you. And after all, my parents are not monsters." By the mood of her relatives, who met her right from the doorstep, she realized that the evening would be hard. Cody's mother immediately assessed the girl, and, not hiding her dislike, offered to go into the room. Carolyn asked her son to help her in the kitchen, where for a long time, in a half-whisper something hissed to her son. Brooke, deciding to offer her help, went to them. But already from behind the door she heard the woman's words. "You understand that you need a completely different girl, much less a wife. A wife of the same status as ours, socially accepted and educated. And this beggar would be better suited to a longshoreman from her store." The girl could not stand it and went into the kitchen. Her face burned with shame and resentment, and her eyes were filled with tears. Barely restraining her emotions, she said quietly, "Thank you for the welcome." She literally jumped out into the street like she was scalded and walked toward the bus stop. At that moment she realized that no amount of love with Cody would soften her parents' heart and they would not be able to accept her as a daughter-in-law. The girl could not hold back her tears and wept bitterly. At this time, her lover, realizing that her parents could not change their minds and that status and money would always come first for them, ran out to get Brooke. He caught up with the girl literally on the next street she was walking, unable to see the road from her tears. Cody stopped his beloved and, holding her tightly to his chest, whispered in her ear. "I will never leave you, and I will always be there for you. I love you so much." They stood hugging for a long time in the barely lit street, and then they walked toward their new life. Realizing that his parents, not approving of his choice, would first deprive him of his livelihood, Cody began looking for a job. Very quickly, he got a job as a manager in one of the trading companies. Brooke had to quit her job at the supermarket and go to work in a small vegetable pavilion for the reason of moving to the very outskirts. All the lovers could afford was a small room. But it was a joy for them to go to bed and wake up together, no matter what the circumstances. A few months later, after returning from work, Cody had a wonderful dinner and a very happy, literally glowing beloved. Brooke took him by the hand and led him to a chair with a mysterious look, showing him to sit down. "We're going to have a baby." She bluntly exhaled those words. There was silence for a minute, then Cody jumped, "Yippee. I'm going to have a son. Brooke, how I love you." Then, picking up Brooke in his arms, he did not even hear her words, through joyful laughter, "Well, why a son, Cody? Maybe a girl, would you love us?" Cody kissed his beloved's face, hands, neck, and thanked her. But one morning, when he left on a short business trip, she received a call that there had been a terrible car accident. There are dead, and among them Cody. Hearing this, Brooke could not believe it. It seemed to her some kind of terrible dream. She, waking up every day, did not want to live, held only the thought of the baby. Odie's parents, from the first day after the funeral, completely turned their backs on her, blaming her for their son's death. Upon learning that Brooke was pregnant, the owner of the vegetable pavilion immediately hinted at her dismissal. There was nothing to pay for housing, money for food, almost nothing left, and also the terrible toxicosis overcame. The girl remembered that her grandmother had once lived in the village, and she hoped that the house was still standing. She could hardly make it, she was struck by the state of the shabby hut, but she had no choice, so she stayed. One day, after seeing Brooke crying bitterly on the bench outside her house, a boy who was returning from fishing came up to her. "Can I help you? Would you like me to give you a fish?" the boy asked. Brooke even smiled, how easy it turned out to be to solve problems as a child. From that day on their friendship began. Brooke, weeping, told Justin of her misfortune, and the boy did everything he could to help her. Listening to Brooke's story, Andrew sat silently, never interrupting her. Then, standing up, he only said, "Pack your things, you can't live here. Justin, help me. We're moving in." Justin shouted joyfully, "Yippee. I'm going to have a brother. Let's even have a little sister." From that day on, Brooke moved in with a farmer, trying in every way to help around the house. The two lonely souls opened up to each other, falling in love unnoticed by themselves. When Brooke gave birth to a healthy and strong baby boy, Andrew registered him under his last name.